I just wanted to say a couple of things. I started the fund that I managed in 1955 when Benjamin Graham said he was going to retire. And I liked Graham very much. And one of the people who rested with him said, "Walter, if you start a fund, I will put money in it." So I said it was a good idea. And we got 19 partners, and most of them put $5,000 in, and we started off with 19 partners and $100,000. I did want to say I never worked with Goldman Sachs. My job was basically with Loeb Rhodes, which was kind of related to the Lehman family, I suppose. But anyway, I just wanted you to know that. So I started in 1955, and I stayed in the field until 2003, and my 2001, I think. I'm not quite sure now. And all I know is that my son turned to me one day and said, "Dad, I can't find any cheap stocks." And I said, "At my age, let's go out of business." And I just knew that the market was going to bubble because the high tech stocks were acting very crazily. And when these things happen, you find that you have to work about 3 years to catch up to all the things that went wrong in the previous 3 years. And life's too short for that. And I enjoy investing. And I would make one other comment. Actually, I was written up by Forbes magazine, and it came out, I think the issue was February 11th. And you might find that interesting. And I'm ready to answer any questions you may have. Even if I don't answer them right, you tell me.
Can you just talk to us a little bit about your relationship with Ben Graham and how it started? Your relationship with Ben Graham.
Well, what happened was I went to work in 19... My father had lost his job, and there was really no money in the family. And so I got a job as a runner at Carl M. Loeb & Company, which became Loeb Rhodes later on. It was a big brokerage firm, but it was small when I went there. And then they put me into the cashier's department. And a year later, I went. I thought I ought to get a little more money. I was making $15 a week, and I thought I could get a little more. So I asked about it, if I could get into the security analysis department. Which is, they called it the statistical department in those days. And I spoke to the partner who had gotten me the job as a runner, and I said, "Could I become a security analyst instead of a statistician?" And he said, "No." I think mainly I had no money and I couldn't bring in brokerage fees. And in those days, all commissions were fixed so that the wealthy people send their family in and they would get fixed commissions. Now, of course, it's a very competitive field. So anyway, he said, "No, you can't do that." But he said, "There's a book called Security Analysis by Benjamin Graham. And if you read that book, you won't need anything else." So I got hold of the Security Analysis, and it was a very good book. And I found that Benjamin Graham, who had written the book, was a customer of Loeb's. And I could see the stocks they owned. And it seems that Loeb would send me to what called the New York Stock Exchange Institute. They were trying to teach the employees on a small basis how the stock exchange worked. And they also, Benjamin Graham, taught a course in statistical analysis. And I took two of his courses, security analysis and advanced security analysis. And I thought Graham was wonderful. He's sort of like Warren Buffett. I mean, you see Graham, you understand the way he thinks, and it works. And incidentally, after I worked for Graham for a number of years, I'm in his office, but he gets a phone call from his lawyer to say that government employees insurance, which he had bought for $1,700,000, and he turned to me and he said, "Walter, if this doesn't work, we can always liquidate and get our money back." That shows what sometimes happens when you make a good purchase. You don't always realize how great it's going to be. So I'm open to questions if you have, and I don't know if I answered anything so far, but ask me what, and if I don't know, I'll tell you.
Well, can you just tell us a little bit about how do you choose stocks? What process do you follow to choose stocks?
Well, I like to buy stocks that are hitting new lows. I like to look at the stocks. Incidentally, I find Value Line very helpful because I don't have a computer, and it's easy to see the statistics. Then when I see the statistics, then I can sort of make a judgment about the company. I don't really talk to the managements. Back in the days when I started, I was in World War II. I enlisted the day after Pearl Harbor, and I was sent overseas to Iran. I'm just telling you this little background. In life, you sometimes are affected by what happens. We wanted to keep Russia in World War II. In World War I, they collapsed and the Germans beat them. And we were afraid that in World War II, that this would happen because the Russians were being beaten by the Germans. And they decided that we couldn't give them equipment through the Murmansk and the North Sea of Russia. So that we decided to open a second front, as it were, by setting up. We had a truck assembly plant there. We were the first troops there. We had ordnance people who put the trucks together. You loaded them up with supplies. You drove it to the northern part of Iran and then turned it over, everything in the truck, to the Russians. And the Battle of Stalingrad was going on, and that was probably the place where the Germans took a big beating because they never got any further. And by doing this, we kept the Germans from going back into France. And as you remember, a couple of years later, we invaded France, and partly because the Germans wanted to be able to be there. So I felt that it was a very important thing we were doing. But because we weren't being killed, nobody knew anything about the Persian Gulf Command. And you might find it an interesting thing. So when I came back, I was there about a year and a half, and then I applied to go to officers' candidate school, so they sent me back to the United States. And in the United States, the Signal Corps was really the place where you learned about communications. And I went in, and because I had enlisted, they sent me there, and I got training. And I was training about the 15th of December. Remember, Pearl Harbor was only December 7th. And on January 31st, I was on my way to Washington, D.C. I'm not so sure if you're aware of it, but before Pearl Harbor, the Americans were training in the South because it was warmer there. And so that when the war broke out, we didn't have any communications to speak of, and they were short code clerks. So I became a code clerk in Washington, D.C. back in 1942. And I worked there for about 6 months, and then the Army founded a company called the 833rd Signal Service Company. It was a bunch of crackerjack ham operators, people who really knew something about the communications. And since they made me a sergeant, and I was kind of in charge of some of this stuff. And I'm only telling you this so you get a little background, because after I became an officer and they sent me, Ben Graham knew about me because I would send him a postcard from time to time where I was, and he wrote me after World War II, and I'm still in the Army, I'm at the Pentagon in Washington, and he asked me when I was going to get out. I said, well, I can get out pretty soon because I've been in for 4 years. And he said, well, he is losing a security analyst who's going to work with his father. Would I be a security analyst? And I said, yes. I was very thrilled about it. And I went to work for him in the beginning of 1946. And in 1955, when Graham decided to retire, that's when I went into the business myself.
You know, what process did you follow to minimize any mistakes? I know mistakes are unavoidable in valuations and security collection, I guess. What steps did you follow to minimize any mistakes?
I don't like to lose money, and therefore I try to buy stocks which I think are somewhat protected on the downside, and then the upside sort of takes care of itself. So the main thing, I think, is to look for companies which don't have a lot of debt, And I don't like the idea of people, well, I'll put it this way. I'd like to get their annual reports. And you can see a little bit about, from the proxy statements and the annual report, how much stock the directors own, who owns a fair amount of stock, and also the history of the company. And I thought the idea of buying a company with a large amount of debt, even though it could work out well because of the leverage, I don't like it. So I look for companies that are selling at new lows. Well, when you buy a stock at a new low, it usually has problems. So I don't like debt. Debt gets people in a lot of trouble, as you know, if you read about MBIA and these other companies that have lent money and then find out they're really in trouble. So I like buying companies which are usually a lot of simple capital. They don't have a lot of debts. They have management owns a fair amount of stock. They have a history about them too. You look at a company and you see how long has it been in business, and what kind of business are they in. Now, I was never very good at judging people's character as such. If you go to a talk to a management, they may be charming people, they may be very nice, but you don't know anything about them. So I found it really was better for me to look at the numbers than to try to look at the people themselves. It serves you, particularly if they don't have a lot of debt. If they don't have a lot of debt, usually that's fairly safe. Now, once in a while, a company, after you own it, decides they're going to buy another company and issue a lot of debt. But if you look at the background of a company and see their history, and that's where Value Line is somewhat helpful, because they usually have 10 or 15 year backs, so you can see where the company was and where it is today. And I don't know if I answer your questions, but the idea is I don't like to lose money.
Now, when the stock goes down, do you automatically buy more or you reconsider the purchase? So when you buy a stock and the price goes down, you keep buying
and it goes down.
If you like it at 10, you're going to like it more at 5.
Well, what happens is lots of times you buy a stock, and if it's having a problem, which is the reason the stock is depressed, it can go lower. And what you want to do is to be satisfied that buying it at a lower price is a good idea. So you look to see how much debt they have. You look at the past history of the company. You see the stock may have gone from 12 to 100, and it goes down from 100 to 70. You say, boy, it's down from 100 to 70. That's great. But you forget that a few years before it was selling at 10. So what you're really trying to do when you invest is to protect your capital. Now, different people have ways of doing that. Sometimes they may think they have better information than you have, which they may have. But I just don't like losing money, and therefore I try to protect it. And the way I do that is, if I like a company and I think it's a good little company, I'll buy more on the way down. And if you're a stockbroker, most stockbrokers do not like to recommend stocks that are going down. Because psychologically, their customers doesn't like it. If they pay buy the stock at $30 a share, and then it goes down to 25, they don't call their customer up and say, "Hey, you ought to buy more at 25," and then it goes down to 20. So, quite often, the broker will not tell you to buy more stock, although it psychologically is good. But for many people who are not in the field, they get very nervous. It goes from 30 to 20, you lost a third of your money. So if it goes back up to maybe 30 again, they may call the customer and say, well, the stock you went down a lot, but it's back where it was, so maybe you should sell it. I don't really like the idea of selling stock that just goes back to where I paid for it. Quite often stocks are on the way down, and that's why I buy them. They're having problems. But then I usually like to try to get 50% profit if I can. The net result of that is you buy a stock at 30 and then it goes up to 50, I'd probably sell it if it was long term. that stock can go to $200 a share, and I've seen that happen. So you have to be a little willing to make mistakes. But I don't really like losing money, and that's one of the reasons that I tend to not like debt.
So the stock goes down. How can you tell it's not a value trap? How do you tell that the stock may not recover? It may never recover. Maybe something has changed that will make the stock, I guess, a long-term losing proposition. So how can you protect, I guess? How can you tell if it's a value trap or a normal, I guess, stock price decline will come back again?
I tend to like stocks that are selling below book value. I also like stocks that are selling with very little debt. Debt gets a lot of people in trouble. All you have to see is these ATM machines where people run into huge amounts of debt. They can't pay it. They go bankrupt. I've been very concerned about borrowing money. And I think that's one of the things that people forget, that debt creates a lot of problems, and therefore you try to avoid debt as much as you can. And if you buy a company and you look at the balance sheet, and the other thing you should do besides looking at the value line is get hold of their annual report. Read their report. See what the balance sheet shows. See what is the history of the company. And you might find that it's... they're having problems, and the reason they're having problems is that their product is not very good, in which case you probably wouldn't own it. But I do find that if you get a stock that's selling at considerably below book value, and it has a good history over the last 20 years, it gives you a certain amount of confidence in it, particularly if the debt is small, and if the management itself owns a fair amount.
Talk to us about the margin of safety. How it came about, how it has evolved over time, what margin of safety Ben Graham was using, and whether you still use what he was using or you have changed, I guess, your views and you've adapted with the times.
I think a margin of safety is if your book value is considerably higher than the market price. You get a margin of safety there. It doesn't guarantee that you'll be right, but it just means that you've got something there. If it gets low enough, somebody may want to buy the company. So the management itself has an interest in making a company a success. So it isn't as if you're fighting the management. The management wants to be a success too. So you're in the same field, but for some reason they've run into some trouble. Their product may be, it's one of the unfortunate things that when you get a thing like the asbestos, it turned out asbestos is bad, and then they get sued and their companies get into a lot of trouble. So you try not to get into a company where it has, problems. And that may be true of the drug industry too, where the people are being sued because they have a product which doesn't work.
My question is, have you ever made a mistake because of your emotions? Ben Graham obviously talks a lot about controlling emotions when investing. I'm wondering if at any point in the past you've made a mistake because of a poor emotional decision. And if so, maybe you could just share that with us. And if not, maybe you could just explain to us, how you control your emotions when investing and what's the best way for somebody to do that.
Well, number one, I try to, and Graham, I think, made the point too, I try not to get emotional about stocks. I don't get emotional. One of the reasons I don't really talk to managements is managements have a way of presenting the facts the way they want you to see them. And I'm not a terribly good judge of people. Warren Buffett really is a remarkable man in that respect. He's very, very good about deciding who is good and who isn't. I like to think that that's why he likes me, but... I just think that what you try to do is to keep your emotions out of investing. and you try to look at the thing logically, not the way you want to have it. I think that, for instance, the getting electric cars would be a great idea, but they don't seem to have made them in such a way that you don't need gasoline. Someday somebody's going to invent it, and then it's going to be a big hit. But I don't feel comfortable buying, say, an automobile company, because at some future time, somebody's going to invent something that'll make it better. I'd rather buy the things the way they are rather than the way you think they may be at a later date.
So basically, instead of being, you know, making speculative decisions, you like to, you know, invest in sort of known in sort of companies that are known, that have a proven track record, and sort of that I guess.
I think that's true. I think that's true. I try to not be involved emotionally. Warren Buffett told me an interesting story a while back, and he tried to control his emotions, and he did it by testing things. The American Broadcasting Company, which is still around, but it's ABC now, he told a broker the stock was selling at $30 a share. I'm not exactly in the field, but it's about that. And Warren said to him, look, I'd like to buy 100,000 shares, but I want to pay 29. And if I can't buy the stock at 29, next day it's going to be 28. So sure enough, the next day, the guy calls up Warren, he tells me this story, and he says, okay, Warren, but you buy 100,000 shares at 29. He said, nope, today I'm buying it at 28. Now, I probably wouldn't have done this. I don't think I had as much control of my emotions as Warren did. Warren said he bought that stock at $26 a share. Now, that's controlling your emotions about how important it is and what price you're willing to pay. I do find that putting in stock to buy at a price, and then that's it. And don't have to watch, well, the ticker's going, it's down a point or it's a half a point. You have a price you want it at, and it may even pay you to have one of the prices where it's you put it in at a fixed price and they can't reduce it. So you may be going away and you'd like to buy the stock, but you don't want to follow it. So you give them, it's good till canceled, which I don't know if you know what that term means, GTC. But you give a broker, you want to buy 1,000 shares of a stock, good till canceled, period. Now, again, if they pay the company pays a dividend, they automatically reduce the price by the amount of the dividend, unless you tell the broker, don't do that. Do not reduce the price if a dividend is paid. I don't know if that helps you.
Yeah, that definitely does. Thank you very much.
I'd like to know, would you rather buy outstanding companies at fair prices or fair companies at outstanding prices?
That's a good question. And I don't think I'd like to buy good companies at what I think they're worth. I really liked, I have no problem buying a good company, but I want it at a discount. I'm looking to make a profit, and I don't want to lose money. And if you can, at times, once in a while, people get very nervous, and you can buy a good company at a fair price. I don't really like, I can't generalize, because each company is different. But if you want to make a profit, you really want to buy a stock at a price that you think it'll go up, say, 50%. Now, it may take several years for that stock to go up, and then you just have to be patient. Now, one day, this goes back to about 1951, you weren't around and so forth, but a fellow came to me and he said, you know, they're the company that we're interested in, that I can't even remember the name of it. It was a company that analyzed other companies, and he said this particular company said that there's a method there where they can copying machines, and the Battelle Institute in New York, I think it's in New York State, has said this company has great possibilities. Stock was selling, it was selling at about 20, and it had lived, gone through the Depression. It was listed on the exchange. It was a small company, And I went into Mr. Graham and I said, you know, this company's got a new product, you know, a copying machine. And he said, well, you know, Walter, we don't really buy stocks like that. Well, of course, it was Xerox, and it went up a great deal. And the only consolation I had was that it had gone from 20 where we saw it, and it had gone to 50, they would have been out of it. And the fact that it went up to 1,000 or 2,000 after splits, I wouldn't have bought it. I bought it only because historically this seemed to be an interesting stock. But he was right that it really, you didn't know that this particular product was going to be such a success. The only thing you could say was the Vattel Institute said that it was good. So what you try to do when I invest is not to lose money. And to do that, you usually want to buy stocks that are having problems. And most companies, when they have problems, get some help. It doesn't, you know, the directors are upset, the president is upset, why is the company doing badly? And that's one reason I like companies which have no debt, because then you don't have to worry about paying it off. And then you want to look and see why. Quite often, the stock market acts emotionally. People act emotionally. Bad news, bad news is causes trouble. So what you try to do is you try not to get involved with the emotions of buying and selling stocks. And if you're managing money for other people, you've got a responsibility, and therefore you don't want to. And so what we did, we never told our limited partners, because we were a partnership, we never told them what we owned. Because we felt that that would be, first of all, if we told them what we owned, then people would try to buy the same stock, and you'd have competition. So I told this to a fellow who was interested in investing with us. He said, you know, he said, oh, what's going to stop you from going to Brazil, taking our money? I said, well, I have no desire to go to Brazil, but if you feel nervous about it, don't invest with us. You know, but people have certain emotions, and they wanted to not lose money. And as I say, we didn't tell people what we owned. And one guy came up, and he said, you know, Walter, I can't stand it, not knowing what we own. He was an old man, so I said, well, we own some bankrupt bonds of the Pennsylvania Railroad, which actually turned out very well later. And he said, I can't be in your partnership knowing that. It makes me too upset. So we withdrew. So people act emotionally, and if you know what you own, they know what you own, and they look at it, oh, I don't like that stock. Then they call you on the phone, and then they say, well, why did you own it? I don't want to hear people complaining. They trusted me with their money, and that's what a lot of the hedge funds do. They don't disclose what they own.
Could you comment on, or maybe give us three key personality traits that you think are essential to being a successful value investor?
I think a personality trait I would think would be to be calm. Not be too emotional about what you did. Do it intellectually. I think if you get emotionally involved in a stock, it affects your judgment. And Ben Graham also had that characteristic. And he didn't like to talk to companies. He felt that they would affect how he felt. Different people have their different abilities. If you have a kind of a logical policy, and you meet a guy who's running a company and you're talking to him and you like him, you may feel that you can emotionally buy the stock because you feel comfortable with him. And I wouldn't be good enough at it, so I would say I only will buy a stock that I think is cheap. And the people who, I mean, we have a company up in Canada, I think, called Hollinger. Mr. Black was a crook, and he had a big name and a wealthy man, and people bought his securities and they lost a lot of money. And I don't think I would have gotten involved with him, because I don't think you buy a stock unless it's very cheap, and then you look at the man. And I think it's also helpful to get the annual reports of companies. Read the annual reports. See if it fits in with what you think. And look at the results over the years. And if you see a company that's depressed, and it's usually depressed because they're having trouble earning money. People love to make money, and if the company's having a problem, that you know may not want to own that stock. On the other hand, it may be a problem, a temporary problem, and not a permanent one. And I do think people act emotionally, and people who advise them also don't like to have problems, so they tend to stay away from these companies, which may be good buys. But again, you try to keep your emotions in control, and you look at the facts, and you see where the dirge, and different people can do things differently. I don't happen to like the people who go in and they say, well, this stock is cheap, we're going to buy it and liquidate it and close it off, and they make themselves money. I couldn't do that. You know, again, you have your different personalities. I like companies to be a success, and I've many stocks that I've sold over the years have gone up a lot after I sold them. Somewhat I sold them, and I don't say, oh my God, I could have made so much more money, and I didn't. Forget it. You sold them, and you go on to something else. So I think emotions have a lot to do with success.
The Forbes article written on you says you've lived through 17 recessions. And I was wondering, if we're going into a recession, if you feel that the next recession is any different from the previous ones?
I have not tried to get involved with what's going to happen in business. I've tried to stay away from that. If you ask me, I'd say your guess is as good as mine. I don't know if you're going to have a recession that'll be... I do think that the politicians don't like to have a recession because it's not too good for them, and they may try to do things to help. But I find that I like to buy stocks on the basis of what they're worth and not trying to figure out what's going to happen in business. It saves me a lot of grief.
Do you find that a recession is a better time to buy a stock, to find a cheap stock?
You may have opportunities in buying a stock. My own feeling is if the stock is cheap, I wouldn't worry too much. And they didn't have debts. They had a nice record, but for some reason or other, the public is emotional. It may give you a great opportunity to buy stocks, and you may take advantage of that. But again, I found that not trying to guess what the market's going to do or what's going to happen in the future, I think it's really better if you just buy the companies that you have a good value. And then maybe you have to wait a little bit longer. But it solves a lot of problems for me. Don't try to figure out what's going to happen in the securities market or in the economic situation. Now, in 1929, we had this big, tremendous crash. But you could have seen that before. You could have seen in 1926 the stock market was getting higher in 30 days, so you had this big break. But you wouldn't have been buying stocks in 1928 because you thought the stock market was too high. So the fact that suddenly it collapsed, you hurt a lot of people. But if you read Ben Graham's book, and you see that he's not terribly emotional about what he does. And when he lectured, he did something I thought was very unusual. He talked about stocks which are undervalued, or he thought they were undervalued. And he liked to compare stocks. He took Coca-Cola and Colgate-Palmolive. And why? Because they appeared the same on the financial page. And then he compared Coca-Cola to... Now, a Coca-Cola was basically a product company, and Colgate Palmolive manager for toothbrushes and so forth. And I noticed they're still both around. But I thought it was, he used that as a good example, and they compared them and so forth. But I just like to buy individual stocks. I'm not saying that that was a great way to go, but I do think it's interesting to compare different companies in this. If you could, in the same field, it might be interesting. One of the companies may be much better than the others, and if you compare two liquor companies or two companies that were doing so much the same thing, you might find one is selling at a higher price than the other, and you might decide you want to buy the one selling at the lower price. Remember this, I don't like to lose money.
I wanted to ask you whether you feel over the recent years that the market has become more efficient and good values are harder to find because management turns over so much more often now.
I think that's a good question, and I think they were the thing called the efficient market in which all stocks sold at where they should sell at. And I think that there are, in that period, and almost any period, there are differences. And your job as an analyst is to see why one stock is selling above another. And I think I like to own companies where they're having problems in that industry. And then you have an opportunity. There may be good companies and some that are not so good. But if they're an industry which is having a problem, look at the companies in it, and you may find a real good buy there. I think today, because there are so many security analysts, you get a lot more competition than you used to. But I don't think value analysts are really happy about buying stocks that are going down. And sometimes that's the best way to, and we used to do that. We'd buy stocks on the way down and sell them on the way up. And the only problem is I think it's much more difficult to know when to sell than when to buy. You're dealing with other people's money, and that gives you a responsibility. And I must say, I never associated with some of the people who did illegal things. And that may have been luck, but it also was that these people were interested in taking advantage of others. But if you're dealing with people, and some of them you feel are a little, I won't say not ethical, but, you know, you had some question with them, don't get involved. It's so much easier, you know, they say, you don't have to remember what's happened because you didn't do anything wrong. And I think there are people in Wall Street and other that want to take advantage of you. So you try to be ethical, and if you tell the truth, you don't have to remember. I don't know if that's a good advice. I like it.
Mr. Schloss, we were wondering what your personal view is on diversification between industries as well as between sort of stocks and bonds. What do you feel about diversification?
That's an interesting thing about industries. I really don't have an opinion. Well, I'll say this. I'm going to stay away from the computer industry because I don't understand it. I'm too old for it. And I know there's a great future in it, but I just don't know how to look at it. So I just stay away. So I'm not involved in computer stocks. That doesn't mean they're bad. And if you know your computer business, you may know, you know, one stock is better valued than others. But it's a field that's changing constantly. And I kind of like companies, I don't know, Campbell's Soup, for example. I don't say you should buy Campbell's Soup. I don't even have to follow it. I'm just saying it's a staple that's been around a long time. And I think I'm more comfortable with that kind of a company than going into new industries. But again, it depends on the person. I don't know, what was the other question?
Between stocks and bonds, would you be 100% stock, or do you sort of mix between the two?
Well, there is a problem with that. There's, over the years, there tends to be an inflationary factor in there. That, and the reason for it is that people want things, government wants things, and they have debt, and then there's a certain amount of inflation. So that owning a bond, unless it's a very high interest bearing bond, you'll never make a lot of money. You get a nice income, and I don't know in Canada if the taxes are very high on dividend income, but I feel more comfortable owning stocks because I think there is growth. There is growth in America, and I think there's growth in Canada, although I must say I'm not really familiar with Canada. But I think it's a great country, and therefore there are opportunities for people to grow. I don't read much about Canada. You know more about it. You're a Canadian. You know more about Canada than I do. I just think that growth is very an important thing, and if your taxes are too high, you kind of hurt people from growing. I like stocks better. Because an inflationary factor in bonds, at the end of the time, you get the most you do is get your money back, and you get interest on your money. But you'll find very few people that became millionaires by owning bonds. They may inherit it, but they don't make it. But in stocks, you can make it. You can, if you happen to hit the right area, you can be very successful. And I think that for young people like you, I would think that you would focus on stocks rather than bonds. Bonds are for old people. That's my theory.
Thank you very much.
Could you please discuss your experience raising capital for your personal fund in the 50s as a young fund manager? And any sort of mistakes or ideas that you would change or things you'd do differently?
I'm not a very aggressive man about by going around, and I'll tell you a story about Warren Buffett, which I thought was sort of cute. Warren, after he left Graham Newman, when Mr. Graham decided to retire, he went, and Graham Newman decided to liquidate, he went across the street to see one of the people who lived there, a very nice guy, and his wife, and they had four children, I think, and Warren said, I think I can help you with your investment. And his wife said, oh, you can't. How can you give money to the young guy? He's 20 years old. He's got suntanned. And so they didn't. Well, the man's name was Don Keough, and he went to doubt, and he ended up as president of Coca-Cola. And his wife, who I meet when we sometimes have these meetings, you know, she's always thinks about that. Because he was young and he wanted to have him invest, she didn't think that was a good idea. So you really, when you go into business for yourself, you really probably should work for somebody else first to get the experience of the way it is. And then if you have some money or your family has money, they might give it to you. And then you get your feet wet. You have some experience in this thing. Now, I was lucky in one respect. People had a terrible experience in the 1932 Depression, and they didn't forget it for many years. And I remember this man saying, he's going to put money in, he said, how can you start a fund? Don't you know the Dow Jones went up to high with 381, and the Dow Jones now is 400. And how can you start your business now? I said, well, somebody's offered to put some money in it. The timing was there. But people had long memories. And so what you want to do, if you want to have people or clients, you first of all, I think, have to look at the values. And then if you're somebody in your family has some money, maybe they would let you manage it for a while. And you get a feel for understanding what you've got. It's very difficult to start a fund, and I think particularly when you don't want to lose people. You don't want to lose money for people. So if you like mathematics and you like the idea of investing, I think you can do it. I just think you have to control your emotions.
Back to me again. What is the biggest mistake a novice investor.
But my biggest mistake, I kind of forget my mistakes, I must admit. I'd have to think about my biggest mistake. I really offhand don't know. I think you can say, well, the mistakes were different, that you put more money in on a stock that had gone down. We didn't lose money very often, and that's why I kind of wiped it out of my mind. We didn't sometimes buy a lot of stock because I was a little nervous about putting too much money in that stock, so we never put too much money. We had I'd owned over 100 stocks most of the time, and that way we had a big diversification. I'm trying to remember well, I'll give you an example of one, and I don't even remember the name anymore. I bought this stock, and it was selling around $2 a share, and I held it for quite some time, and it was a company that manufactured stuff for the Army, and the man who owned it owned about 80% of the company, and he offered to sell, to buy or take all the stock at about $7 a share. At the time it had a working capital of 10. And I didn't have much of it, but I had about $100,000 worth of the stock. And I objected. There was a lawyer who said, look, I can handle this if you, I won't charge you a fee because I want to stop it. So he put it in court and he complained about the way the tender offer was made. And he won in the court in the New York State. So then they made an appeal to the next higher court in New York State, the Court of Appeals, I think it's called. And anyhow, he won by a vote of 3-1. And now the man said who owned this stock, Mr. Berlin, I remember his name. And he said, a friend of mine who was an insurance man said, you're going to be sued for harassment by this man. Meanwhile, I had about $100,000 with the stock and I sued him for harassment because he lost this. I said, it isn't worth my while. I'll just give in. So I bet with the man and I took the original price of 7. And of course, at that time, the Reagan administration came in, defense went way up, and I'm sure he did very well. But emotionally, I found getting involved in legal action was, I didn't like it. I found, there are people that don't mind it, but I found that it was an unpleasant experience. I didn't never really focus on my mistakes, or for that matter, on the profits. If I sold a stock and it went up a lot more after I sold it, it was out of my mind. I think what I try to do is to avoid the mistake of getting involved with people who were not particularly ethical. There was a man named, I don't remember the man's name, he came out of Canada actually, and he sold a company called Croy Oil, and he was not supposed to do it without registering it with the SEC. So Croy Oil, he was caught and he was sent to prison. He made billions of dollars out of it. And after he got out of prison, he thought he had all this money and he entertained people. Now, that gentleman, whatever his name was, he made a lot of money out of the stock market. But it's not somebody that I want to associate with. You try to stay with good people. But I can't tell you what my biggest mistake was.
How you find the investment environment in Asia and maybe China in particular undergoing an industrial revolution right now? Do you have any views on China?
I have definite feelings about it, and I did spend some time in China actually on a tour. I do not buy foreign companies, and that did not include Canada. I have been a little bit in Canada, but basically I want to be protected, and I feel that most countries of the world do not have an SEC. It's not easy to judge them. I think certain companies, countries, that insiders know more about what's going on can buy the stock. And I've stayed at 10 way away. I'd rather buy United States companies because I understand them. I don't really understand foreign companies. And China is one of them I don't understand. And I feel very uncomfortable owning a company. And this was true with a good example would be Brazil, with the man there just took over the oil company of Chevron or one of the oil companies. He wanted it, so he took it. And I feel that China is in that category. If you get stock in it, and then all of a sudden the Chinese government says, well, we're going to pay you what we want to pay you, and goodbye. And I feel comfortable owning stock where I feel I have some protection. So I tend not to get involved with European companies where I don't understand them particularly. Their annual report is in German or French or something. So I tend to buy American companies. That doesn't mean I'm right. It's just that I feel comfortable because I understand the situation and I don't understand another company.
Thank you very much for your time today. You touched earlier on the example of Xerox in its early days and the difficulty of knowing when to sell a successful investment. I think you noted that you find it easier to decide when to buy, and in some instances have sold out of very good investments too early. Could you talk to us a little bit about, with a value play that has been a successful investment, how you know when to sell and whether you tend to sell a stock in its entirety or sell it in small components along the way? So basically, Mr. Frost, how do you know when to sell?
Good question. I think it's, I would say I don't know when to sell. I think basically when a stock gets to be vulnerable, in that if you pay a stock, you paid $50 a share for the stock and it's $100 a share, I'd probably sell it because I made 100% profit and I don't want to worry about it. But we did it, Graham Newman, where I worked, and I would sell on the scale. You wouldn't sell it all at one price. I'd sell some at maybe 85, depending how long I held it. We held the stock for usually about 3 years. We didn't sell it just because you bought it, you didn't sell it. So that you had a time where you got a few reports, you read about them, and you see what the company has been doing. And when you get a profit, I like profits, but I don't have any formula for saying, well, if the stock goes from 50 to 100, I automatically sell it. You look and see it in the meantime. But because remember, the stock has a downside to it too. So the stock gets up high enough, there's a certain amount of vulnerability. You bought a stock at 50, it goes to 100, but you say, I'm not going to sell it, and then it goes down to 50. You feel kind of stupid, and you didn't take advantage of it. So that I tend to sell it on the way up. And that is a problem, is when do you sell a stock? And I have here made a comment which I think might be interesting to you. Ben Graham wrote in his third edition of Security Analysis, which came out in 1951. You can get it at the library. And in there, on page 536, he discussed the difference between price and value. And on page 726, he says special situations, and he discusses them. And I use that as an example. I talked up at Columbia once, Columbia University, and I told them about McDonald's. McDonald's had come down a lot, was selling at $14 a share, you know, the restaurant chain. It was selling at about 14, and it bent out from about 35. And, you know, there were always some problems with these chains that things could happen. So I took it and I said, well, I think it's selling at 14 now. And I used Graham's formula, and his formula, I'll read it to you because I thought it was interesting. He says, let G be the expected gain in points in the event of success. Let L be the expected loss in points in the event of failure. And let C be the expected chance of success expressed as a percentage. Let Y be the expected time of holding in years, and P be the current price of the security. This is an algebraic formula. And you could make your own judgment. The beauty about this particular one, you could use any figures you wanted to, but the idea was, what is the formula? And what you do is you use in this case, I think McDonald's is worth 22, selling at 14. So you're going to make, if you buy it at 14 and then sell it at 22, you've made 8 points. And that, what is the chance of success? So I use that, and I said it's 75% chance of success it would go to 22. And then you multiply that times 100% minus C, which is to be the expected chance of success expressed as a percentage, and it comes out at 600, that is 75%, would be 600 minus 50, and then you divide that by 14, and the denominator was 14, and you'd say it'll take 2 years to work. So you ended up with a formula of 550 for the numerator, 28, 14 times 2 is 2 years, is 28, and it comes out of 19.6% as a return per year. So you make a 19.6% on a return per year. The beauty of this thing was you make up your own minds. You take a stock, you estimate what you think it's worth, and then you multiply it out and use that formula. And if you get that addition, the third edition of Graham, of the security analysis, which came out in 1951. And the reason I mention this is because Ben was working on this book, and he turned to me and he said, Walter, I've got a lot of things in the appendix. You let me know if there's anything in there that I should put in. And I've picked this particular thing, which I thought was interesting, because you can make up your own mind what you think the company is worth, and then see whether how long it would take to do it. And it's just a judgment factor, but it's a great experience.
Just one other very quick one. In terms of asset allocation, you have noted a fondness for with asset allocation. You've said that you like stocks over bonds generally. How much would you allocate to an individual stock? What is the maximum percentage of a portfolio in your experiences that you would allocate to one name?
It depends a little bit on how wealthy or how much you want to put into a stock. If you only have a few stocks, you could, I use diversified, I had 100 stocks, and that way you didn't have one stock that had too much. I would say, if it's really a good thing, you really liked it very much, you might put 20% in one stock. I don't think I'd put more than 20%. So just figure you've got $1 million, and how you're going to invest it, and you like something, you put $200,000 in. That's a lot of money. But if you put in $500,000, you risk it half your debt worth. So you have to limit how much money you want to put into it. And if you're managing other people's money, you don't want to have them nervous about it. So you may put in less than that. You put 10% in. So again, it depends on how strong, how optimistic you are about your judgment. And another thing I think would be fair to say, if you feel that the society, for example, when we had this the period where there were these people were buying tech stocks way up, and it was dangerous. And I read a book by Mr. Perkins, and he talked about the bubble, and you can probably get it in the library, and he talked about the bubble of this thing, and I thought, you know, the guy makes sense. So that I'd actually shorted a few stocks, which I normally don't do, because I find shorting stocks is upsetting to me. I don't like to do it because you're risking your capital. But I thought that the Perkin book is worth looking at. And certainly, I would say Benjamin Graham's I like that third edition. It came out in 1951 before you were born, but it's probably not in print anymore. But you can get it at, you can get it at the library, I'm sure. Read it, you'll find it interesting.
When you're looking at a company, do you rely solely on historical financials and the annual report, or do you do a lot of outside research?
I like to buy stocks selling below book value. It gives me a certain amount of protection. I also like stocks that don't have much debt. That gives me a certain amount of protection. Then you look at the company itself. Well, the company may not be a great company, but if it's got a lot of book value, and the management, well, and you look back for the last 20 years, you'll see. Now, this article that I wrote in Forbes, which you might get hold of, I used about six stocks. I gave it examples of the stocks I recommended or thought they were okay. And, you know, and you can disagree with them, but at least I put them down. And so you see if you can get hold of it. Forbes, February 11th issue of issue, and as I say, there's an article there about me. So it may help you see where I've come from. I don't know where I'm going, but I know where I came from.
I wanted to just ask you a quick question about more along the industry lines that you enjoy. You mentioned in the past that you like to avoid industries that you're not comfortable with, but I was wondering how you become comfortable with a particular industry that you might have some interest in.
I'm not quite sure I got the question, but I'll try to answer it. Tell me if I'm mistaken. I kind of like companies that manufacture goods, basically. I think if you ask me, do you buy an airline stock? No, I haven't, but I don't know enough about the airlines. And, you know, the airlines is an area which has had fabulous growth, but the stockholders never did very well with it. So getting a growth stock is not always helpful if you can't, if it doesn't come out so that you can make some money out of it. So I've tried to buy companies which had simple capitalizations. They had stocks and they had debts, and you want very little debt, and then you look back over the last 20 years, you see what the company has done, and then get an annual report. One of the things I really don't want to do is get in a company that's got the management, I won't say it's crooked, but I'm just saying that it's not ethical. You try to stay away from people that are out to maybe to take advantage of you. And it's your money, or your money that you're managing. You've got a responsibility, and then when you have a responsibility, you have to act responsibly. And I like the only buying of stock which is protected on the downside. And usually is a stock where the outlook is not good. Then again, then you'd have to look at it. But I would use it. I'd use Value Line as an example, so you can get a picture of where the stock was 10 years ago, where the book value is, what the debt structure is. Then send for the annual report if you're interested, because there are an awful lot of security analysts out there now, and I think a lot of them run by the computer. And the computer doesn't think. It just gives you what you want to hear. It's there. But I like the idea of people being at the end of the thing rather than just numbers. I don't know if that helps you at all. The point is, you don't want to lose money. You don't want to lose money, and you have a client's responsibility, and it's very important. And Graham was a very philosophical man. He writes, I think, The Intelligent Investor is a great book. I want Buffett says the greatest book he ever read. But he wrote intelligently and unemotionally. And I think those are good qualities to have in investments. It may not be good in some other field, but if you lose money, it's very upsetting to you and your client. So you try to protect yourself, and one way to do it is to buy stocks which are depressed. And then you want to be sure they're not going to go broke. They want to be, maybe the industry is having troubles. And then you have to weigh that against the opportunities.
Hello. In Canada, we have a lot of public companies that are family-owned. So what do you think about special voting classes of shares?
When I first started working, there were people who had, I remember Easy Washing Machine was an example. They had an A and a B stock, and the A stock was the voting stock, and the B stock was the same, except they had no votes. And those companies have gradually disappeared. There are not many family stocks around. Most of the people, it seems to me, have sold, over the years, have sold their businesses. I don't know exactly where, you know, a family having a good business, at some point they want to leave it to their family. And generally, I think it's probably better that they sell it, because I think that unless the family has got a very bright, you know, grandchildren and so forth will take over. I was always struck by the fact that the Rockefellers, who were really really intelligent and smart people, I don't think they bought any shares of Berkshire Hathaway. Now, you'd think that they would, because this is, they didn't need all the income, but it just shows that Warren is a very brilliant guy. But the problem is that if you wanted income, you didn't get any from him. All you got is a capital gain. But if you needed income, and you have to wait 20 years to cash in on it, so that a growth stocks are good for wealthy people. I think that's true. But I like the idea of being able to sell your stock. Now, people who own a business are waiting for the next generation to take it over. And I don't know enough about Canada to know what the tax situations are, whether it pays for the family to keep the business or not, because I don't know the inheritance qualities. But, you know, you'd have to know the tax laws, too. But I don't think families over the years have benefited by keeping the business going. I mean, to turn it over to someone else, maybe, but...
Okay, we're almost out of time. I want to ask you a last question, which I normally ask to every speaker we had, and this is, what is the most important thing in investing and in life that you have learned over the past 50 or so years?
Well, I think honesty is the best thing you could have. It just, it solves a lot of problems. And just you, when you have an ethics and you have a problem, and that a lot of comes from the family, I think, basically. I don't know if I'm answering your question, but it seems to be a good, just tell the truth, you don't have to remember.
Great, thank you very much.
I don't know.
I'd like to thank you for this valuable and very informative interaction with my students. The Value Investing Guest Speaker Series is a critical part of my course, as beyond the numbers, my students need to understand the character, the personality, and the temperament of value investors, and internalize the character development I'm trying to instill in them. So I really appreciate your helping me do this, and in the process create a memorable experience for me and my value investing students. On behalf of all of us, I will be sending you a small gift, a token of our appreciation, as a memento of this event. Well, thank you very much, and good evening.
Well, I'm glad. Thank you very much.
I
don't do this very often, but I think it's probably helpful. It keeps me younger.
Good night.
Thank you. I just wanted to say a couple of things. I started the fund that I managed in 1955 when Benjamin Graham said he was going to retire. And I liked Graham very much. And one of the people who rested with him said, Walter, if you start a fund, I will put money in it. So I said it was a good idea. And we got 19 partners, and most of them put $5,000 in, and we started off with 19 partners and $100,000. I did want to say I never worked with Goldman Sachs. My job was basically with Loeb Rhodes, which was kind of related to the Lehman family, I suppose. But anyway, I just wanted you to know that. So I started in 1955, and I stayed in the field until 2003, and my 2003, my 2001, I think. I'm not quite sure now. And all I know is that my son turned to me one day and said, "Dad, I can't find any cheap stocks." And I said, "At my age, let's go out of business." And I just knew that the market was going to bubble because the high tech stocks were acting very crazily. And when these things happen, you find that you have to work about 3 years to catch up to all the things that went wrong in the previous 3 years. And life's too short for that. And I enjoy investing. And I would make one other comment. Actually, I was written up by Forbes magazine, and it came out, I think the issue was February 11th. And you might find that interesting. And I'm ready to answer any questions you may have. Even if I don't answer them right, you tell me.
Can you just talk a little bit about your relationship with Ben Graham and how it started? Your relationship with Ben Graham.
Well, what happened was I went to work in 19... My father had lost his job, and there was really no money in the family. And so I got a job as a runner at Carl M. Loeb and Company, which became Loeb Rhodes later on. It was a big brokerage firm, but it was small when I went there. And then they put me into the cashier's department. And a year later, I thought I ought to get a little more money. I was making $15 a week, and I thought I could get a little more. So I asked about it, if I could get into the security analysis department. Which is, as they called it, the statistical department in those days. And I spoke to the partner who had gotten me the job as a runner, and I said, could I become a security analyst instead of and he said no. I think mainly I had no money and I couldn't bring in brokerage fees. And in those days, all commissions were fixed so that the wealthy people send their family in and they would get fixed commissions. Now, of course, it's a very competitive field. So anyway, he said, no, you can't do that. But he said, there's a book called Security Analysis by Benjamin Graham. And if you read that book, you won't need anything else. So I got hold of the Security Analysis, and it was a very good book. And I found that Benjamin Graham, who had written the book, was a customer of Loeb's. And I could see the stocks they owned. And it seems that Loeb would send me to it called the New York Stock Exchange Institute. They were trying to teach the employees on a small basis how the stock exchange worked. And they also, Benjamin Graham, taught a course in statistical analysis. And I took two of his courses, security analysis and advanced security analysis. And I thought Graham was wonderful. He's sort of like Warren Buffett. I mean, you see Graham, you understand the way he thinks, and it works. And incidentally, after I worked for Graham for a number of years, I'm in his office when he gets a phone call from his lawyer to say that government employees insurance, which he had bought for $1,700,000, and he turned to me and said, Walter, if this doesn't work, we can always liquidate it and get our money back. That shows what sometimes happens when you make a good purchase. You don't always realize how great it's going to be. So I'm open to questions if you have, and I don't know if I answered anything so far, but ask me what, and if I don't know, I'll tell you.
Well, can you just tell us a little bit about how do you choose stocks? What process do you follow to choose stocks?
Well, I like to buy stocks that are hitting new lows. I like to look at the stocks. Incidentally, I find Value Line very helpful because I don't have a computer, and it's easy to see the statistics. Then when I see the statistics, then I can sort of make a judgment about the company. I don't really talk to the managements. Back in the days when I started, I was in World War II. I enlisted the day after Pearl Harbor, and I was sent overseas to Iran. I'm just telling you this little background. In life, you sometimes are affected by what happens. We wanted to keep Russia in World War II. In World War I, they collapsed and the Germans beat them. And we were afraid that in World War II, that this would happen because the Russians were being beaten by the Germans. And they decided that we couldn't give them equipment through the Murmansk and the North Sea of Russia. So that we decided to open a second front, as it were, by setting up. We had a truck assembly plant there. We were the first troops there. We had ordnance people who put the trucks together. You loaded them up with supplies. You drove it to the northern part of Iran and then turned it over, everything in the truck, to the Russians. And the Battle of Stalingrad was going on, and that was probably the place where the Germans took a big beating because they never got any further. And by doing this, we kept the Germans from going back into France. And as you remember, a couple of years later, we invaded France, and partly because the Germans wanted to be able to be there. So I felt that it was a very important thing we were doing. But because we weren't being killed, nobody knew anything about the Persian Gulf Command. And you might find it an interesting thing. So when I came back, I was there about a year and a half, and then I applied to go to officers' candidate school, so they sent me back to the United States. And in the United States, the Signal Corps was really the place where you learned about communications. And I went in, and because I had enlisted, I